Hello, I'm Bobby Galuba with OobaTech.com. It's Monday, September 21st, 2015, and welcome to my seventh video, recorded on Saturday, July 18th, 2015, and Sunday, July 19th, 2015. In this video, I originally thought I was going to be showing you how to do a full brake job on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche, because occasionally when I'd step on the brakes, I hear squeaking, which I thought was being caused by the brake pads being too thin and allowing the wear sensors on the brake pads to make contact with the discs. But as you'll see in my inspection, I found that I had plenty of thickness on the brake pads and didn't need to do a full brake job on the brake system. And in regards to the squeaking sounds that I heard, I decided not to take any further steps to try to remedy the problem, since it was more of just a nuisance and not an actual mechanical problem. So let's go ahead and get the video rolling and you'll see what steps I took to inspect the brakes on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche. Okay, it's Saturday, July 18th, 2015 at 4:33 p.m. in the afternoon. And for this job, what I first want to do is show you some of the safety equipment, tools and supplies that I plan on using that I think I'll need to perform the job. So first, the most important thing probably is a repair manual. This is a Haynes repair manual. Chilton's also makes repair manuals, and then you can also get factory service manuals from a website which I believe is helminc.com or helminc.com. I think it's helminc.com. And they have really good factory service manuals that are really, really detailed for most brands of vehicles. So this is good. It shows you instructions for how to do various repairs and maintenance. And it also has a lot of good reference information like torque specifications. Okay, the next thing you want to have is at least one good rag for cleaning up parts and getting grease off your fingers. Old paper towels work well as well. Some good sunscreen to protect yourself from the sun. This is a combination sunscreen and also mosquito repellent, so it'll keep the sun off and the bugs. Hat goes well too if you're gonna have a lot of sun. You definitely want to wear a hat to keep the sun off your face and also to protect your head from getting too much grime on it. I've got my safety glasses right here. These are your number one piece of safety equipment. You never want to work on your vehicle without them, because your eyes are much more valuable than any of your vehicles and any of your tools and your time as well. So don't take any chances and always wear your safety glasses, even if you think it's just something minor that you're doing. Here are some gloves, a good set of gloves. Those will protect your hands while you're working and help keep them clean. They'll also help to protect you from knuckle busters, like if you're cranking really hard on a wrench and the wrench breaks loose, your hand may fly off and bash into another piece of the vehicle. So you want to have some gloves on to help protect your hands to keep them from getting cut up. All right. Now I'm going to have to take the wheels off my vehicle to do the brake job. And so what I have here is I have the lug wrench that I keep in my vehicle, the extension rods that are used with the jack here, and then I also keep this big wrench here. It's a half-inch drive wrench with a half-inch to 3/8 inch adapter, because the sockets I have, in fact I'll put the adapter back on there, it's got a little button here that you press, you let go and it locks on there. Okay, it's spring loaded. So I've got this wrench, the ratcheting wrench, alright, and I also have these special sockets. These are for the special lug nuts that I have on my wheels, and they're designed this way. They're not hexagonal to make it a little more difficult for people to steal the wheels from the vehicle, since most
tool supply places don't have these types of sockets. You have to get these when you get the wheels and the lug nuts to go with them. So I have these. Then I have these two sockets that I'll use to turn those other sockets. These are from my Metrench tool set, which I've shown in some of my other videos. This particular one is the 7/8 inch and 22 millimeter one. And this I'll use for this socket here. And then here's the 3/4 inch and 19 millimeter socket from the Metrench set, from my Metrench set. And here it is, it says Metrench right here. And that'll go on there. And what I'll do is I'll just put these together like this. And I can either use this wrench or I can use the little lug wrench that I have with me as well to take my lug nuts off my wheels. Okay, so let's take that apart. All right, and again, I have the jack, which I'll use to raise the vehicle. And let's look over here. I have two sets of jack stands. I have these larger ones, and these are 6-ton or 12,000-pound capacity jack stands, and those I plan on using under the front of the vehicle. And then these smaller ones, which are also shorter, these are 2.25-ton or 4,500-pound jack stands, and I think I'll be able to use these under the rear of the vehicle. I'll put them under the rear axle and hold up the rear of the vehicle with these. I want to raise up both ends of the vehicle at the same time and do all of the wheels, do the brakes on all of the wheels at once, and then bleed the brakes as well after I'm done. So I want to make sure that both ends are jacked up so that I can do all of that in one shot. Okay, the next thing I have over here is brake cleaner. So once I get the wheels off, I want to clean the brakes first. So I thought maybe about 8 cans. Let's see, I think I have, yeah, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, 8 cans of brake cleaner here. I figured about 2 cans per wheel should probably be enough, hopefully, to get them all cleaned up. Now, you want to use this and you don't want to use compressed air because a lot of brake pad material is made of asbestos, and asbestos is very bad to breathe. It's carcinogenic and can cause cancer, so you don't want to be breathing in that dust. And if you use a spray like this, it'll help to clean off and capture that dust, and you can just have it fall into a drain pan and collect it there. Okay, so you definitely want to use some of this spray-on brake cleaner. And also make sure you're wearing your safety glasses when you do this, because you don't want to be spraying it on and having it go in your eye, because that can really hurt your eyes. All right, the next tool I have is this 8-inch C-clamp. Let's see if we can get a better view of that. All right, now the C-clamp, what I'll use this for is to compress the brake calipers. I'm going to need to compress the brake calipers because the new brake pads that I'm going to be putting on there, they're going to be thicker than the old pads, and so I'll need to have more room, and I'll need to open up the calipers more so that the thicker brake pads can fit in the calipers. So I'll use this 8-inch C-clamp to compress the calipers before I install the new brake pads. Now, since my vehicle is equipped with ABS or an anti-lock braking system, when I compress the calipers, I have to open up the bleed screw to prevent damaging the anti-lock braking system. Now, with vehicles that don't have an anti-lock braking system, what you can do is just siphon off some of the brake fluid before you compress the calipers. A good way to do that is with a drinking straw. You can put it in the brake fluid reservoir you can put your finger on top of the straw, lift up the straw, hold it over another container and take your finger off the top of the straw, and then that fluid, the brake fluid, should just drop into the other container. And just repeatedly do that until you drain off enough of the brake fluid from the brake fluid reservoir to allow enough room for more brake fluid to go in there when you compress the calipers. Okay, so again, that's for vehicles without ABS, but if you have ABS, you want to make sure that you open up the bleed screw on each one of the calipers instead to allow room for the brake fluid to exit. Okay. Now the next thing you'll want to have is some wire. Now this is a wire from an old hanger, and you want to have this so that you can hang the bracket that the caliper mounts to, or excuse me, you want to be able to hang the caliper from the frame of the vehicle, and you don't want it hanging by its hose while you're changing the brake pads and also taking off the rotors, having them turned and then putting them back on. Because if you have the calipers hang from the hose, that can damage the hose, so you don't want to do that. So have some good wire, like wire from an old hanger, to hang your calipers. To hang your calipers from the frame of the vehicle. Now here is my Metrinch tool set, and I've shown this in some of my previous videos as well. The good thing about this tool set is the profile and each one of the sockets and the wrenches. If you notice, it's lobed, and what this allows is for each one of these sockets or the wrenches to be used on both standard and metric size bolts and nuts, and then also they're good for use with nuts that have been rounded off. With standard, like a like 6 or 12 point socket, you may have trouble getting the socket to grip onto the nut if it's rounded. But these, since they touch the flat of the nut, they're good for removing nuts that have been rounded off. Okay, so next, what I have is I have this synthetic brake grease, and I'll use that for the pins in the calipers to lubricate those, and also I'll probably put a little bit on the ends of the brake pads themselves so that they can slide easily in the little tabs or the little brackets that they mount in. Okay, and again, you don't want to get any of this on the brake pads themselves, because that will reduce their braking efficiency. The next thing is this. It's a disc brake quiet. And what I'll do is, before I put the brake pads in the vehicle or in the calipers, I'll spray some of this on the back of each one of the calipers. I'll probably put like 2 coats on the back of each brake pad, and this will help to keep the brakes from squealing when they're in use. Okay, so this is called disc brake quiet, and basically it just helps to provide a cushioned surface to reduce squealing in the brake pads. All right, the next thing are my torque wrenches. I have 2 different torque wrenches. I'm not sure exactly which ones I'll need to use. I've done this procedure before, but it's been a long time, so I'll just have both of them ready depending on what torques I'll need to use for tightening the various nuts and bolts when I'm doing the brake job. All right, now I have my new brake pads. I bought these Duralast Max ones from AutoZone. I bought a set for the front and the rear brakes. Okay, so let's take a close-up of what they look like. Okay, so here's one of the brake pads. All right, here's the surface that actually touches the disc when you apply the brakes. So when you apply the brakes, they get pushed up against the disc, squeeze it, and help slow the vehicle. They're a little bit chamfered or tapered on each end. All right, I'm not quite sure what that middle groove is for, possibly to aid in cooling. I'm not sure though. But this is the brake material. All right. Now, there's also what's called the wear sensor on the brake pad. Now, once the thickness of the brake pad gets all the way down to this little wear sensor, the brakes will start to squeak, which my brakes are currently squeaking, so I think they're probably pretty close to being due for a change, because every time I apply my brakes, I can hear them squeaking. So most likely, it's the wear sensor on one or more of the pads that's scraping up against the disc or more discs on the vehicle and causing them to squeak. So again, if you start hearing squeaking, this wear sensor is most likely the thing that's making a noise, and that's an indication that your brake pads are getting too thin and they need to be changed. Okay, and here's the back of the brake pad right here. And the other ones look similar to this. So there's a set for the front and a set for the back. There's also these little mounting pieces as well. So these are used to mount the brake pads in the calipers. Okay, so we'll use these new ones. We'll replace the old ones with these new ones, because most brake pads I've gotten in the past did not have these as replacements. Now lastly, what I have is I have a one-man brake bleed kit. So what I can use this for is to bleed my brakes once I'm done. I want to make sure I get all of the air out of the brake lines, because again, remember, I'm going to have to, when I compress the calipers, I'm going to have to open up the bleed screw on each caliper when I compress it. And if any air gets in there, I want to get that air out later on before I finish the brake job, because if I don't get the air out, the brakes will be spongy and they won't be very effective. Okay, and then one last supply I have is brake fluid, because I don't want to reuse the old brake fluid. I want to put new brake fluid in there, and this is DOT3 brake fluid. Okay, so those are some of the safety gear, tools, and supplies that I think I'll need for the job that we're going to be doing. Okay, the next thing I want to do is to break loose the lug nuts on my wheels before I raise the vehicle off the ground. So here are the lug nuts, in case you don't know what lug nuts are. They're the nuts that hold the wheel on the vehicle. So I've got six of them on each one of my wheels. And the reason why I want to break them loose before I raise the vehicle is because the vehicle's on the ground right now, and the ground is basically keeping the wheel from spinning while I loosen the lug nuts, because they're on there really, really tight. And if I were to raise the vehicle and try to break them loose, then it would be very difficult for me to hold the wheel still and also apply enough torque to break loose the lug nuts. So I'm just going to break them loose. I'm not going to take them all the way off. The reason why is because I don't want, you know, the vehicle to fall down, of course. I'm just going to break them loose. They'll still be held on there by the lug nuts, or the wheels will still be held on by the lug nuts. But after I break them loose, they'll be easy to take off the rest of the way after I raise the vehicle, and I won't have to worry about trying to hold the wheel still when I'm turning them and loosening them the rest of the way. So again, I want to break loose each one of the lug nuts on the wheels before I raise the vehicle off the ground. And if you see here, it's definitely on the ground. Okay, so I've got my tools, and what I'm going to do is go ahead and break loose the lug nuts. And what I want to do is I want to break them loose in a crisscross pattern. So what I'll probably do is do this lug nut first, then this one, then this one, this one, this one, and lastly this one. So, and that helps to prevent the wheel from warping. Most likely it wouldn't warp anyways, but it's a good idea when you're loosening fasteners which hold down, multiple fasteners which hold something together, it's a good idea to do it in a crisscross pattern. And in fact, some service manuals will give you a specific pattern for loosening or tightening the fasteners that hold something in place, like a cylinder head, for example. So let's go ahead and we'll break the lug nuts on this wheel loose, and then I'll go ahead and I'll do the rest. Okay, so here's my ratchet wrench. It's a 1/2 inch drive. It has a 1/2 inch to a 3/8 inch adapter. And again, I have my two special sockets here for the special nuts that are on my wheels. And these basically are used to help keep people from stealing the wheels, because most people don't have these types of sockets. And then I'll use my little metrinch, the corresponding metrinch sockets to go with them. And those are 3/8 inch drive sockets. Okay, I think this one is for that one there. Actually, maybe not. Let's see here. Yep, that's the right one. Okay, so we'll break this one loose first. And remember, we want to do lefty-loosey, not righty-tighty. We want to do lefty-loosey, which is counterclockwise. We're going to turn the nut this way to loosen it. If we wanted to tighten it, we would turn it this way, righty-tighty or clockwise. Okay, but in this case, we want to take them off, so we're going to do lefty-loosey or counterclockwise. And I want to set, right now it's my ratchet's not set in the proper direction, so I'm going to flip this little switch here, and it'll ratchet when going clockwise, but it'll lock in place and turn the socket when it's going counterclockwise. So that's clockwise, it ratchets, and counterclockwise, it turns the socket. So I just want to break it loose again. I don't want to take it all the way off. Okay, so now it's loose. Now we'll go on to the next one. Actually, we'll leave those together there. We'll get these right here. And remember, we want to alternate. So that one's broken loose. Go to this next one, break it loose. Then this one, break it loose. Then this one. Okay. And then lastly, this one here. So they should all be fairly loose. Let's just double check. Yeah, that one's loose. That one's loose. That one's loose. Yep. That one's loose. That one. And we'll just double check the first one, and that should be loose as well. So yeah. Yeah, it's loose enough for me to turn with my hand. So I didn't take them all the way off. I just broke them loose, and then now once I get the vehicle off the ground, it'll be easy to take them off the rest of the way. So always remember to break loose your lug nuts before you raise your vehicle off the ground. Okay, since I'm going to have all of the wheels off my truck at the same time, in addition to replacing the brake pads, I also want to rotate the wheels. Now, this doesn't mean just spinning them while they're on the vehicle. What it means is to change the position in which they're installed on the vehicle. And the reason you want to do this is because of the fact that on most vehicles, the tires wear at different rates depending on where they're installed on the vehicle. Say, for example, I think in most cases the front wheels will wear faster than the rear wheels, I believe. And also it can vary from side to side as well. So at different intervals, what you want to do to allow the tires to kind of wear at the same rate on an average is to change their positions periodically. And right here in this diagram, what I have is the recommended pattern for rotating the tires on my vehicle, which I got from the service manual. If you see here, here's the driver's side front wheel, which I'll just use DF for short, the passenger side front wheel, the driver's side rear wheel, and the passenger side rear wheel. And what I'll do is, before I take the wheels off of the vehicle, I'll mark on each one of the rims with a crayon, I'll mark DF, PF, PR, or DR, depending on what position they're installed on the vehicle. And then when I go to put them back on the vehicle, what I'll do is I'll take the one wheel that was in the driver's side front wheel position, and I'll bring it straight back and install it on the driver's side rear wheel position. I'll take the passenger side front wheel and I'll bring it straight back and I'll install it in the passenger side rear wheel position. Alright, then I'll take the wheel that was in the passenger side rear wheel position and I'll bring it in front and on the other side and I'll install it in the driver's side front wheel position. Then I'll take the wheel that was in the driver's side rear wheel position, I'll bring it up front, but I'll also bring it to the other side and I'll install it in the passenger side front wheel position. And what this will allow to happen is, say for example, if the front wheels were wearing faster than the rear wheels, once I do this rotation, the rear wheels will now be in the front wheel positions and the front wheels will now be in the rear wheel position. So if the front wheels are worn a little bit more than what the rear wheels were, the rear wheels, which are now in the front wheel position, will wear a little bit faster and they'll kind of catch up to the wear on the wheels that we put back here. So basically it's just rotating the wheels doesn't mean spinning them on the vehicle, it just means changing their position in which they're installed on the vehicle to allow them to wear at the same average rate. And you don't have to do this too often, but if you notice that, say, the front wheels are wearing faster than the rear wheels, take the front wheels and move them to the back wheel position and bring the back wheels and move them to the front. And also, like as in this pattern, you see the front wheels going straight back, but the rear wheels go forward and to the opposite sides. Okay, so just look in your service manual for your vehicle and see what the recommended tire rotation pattern is. And next what I'll do is I'll go and I'll mark on my rims with some crayon just so that I know what positions they went into, or they came, what positions the wheels came from. Okay, so here's my passenger side front wheel, and what I'm going to do is just take this little crayon here and mark PF on the rim. Let's see what that looks like. So P, whoa, a little slippery there. PF, not real neat, but you can see that it's marked on there. And it's not permanent, but it'll stay on there for a while. And once you go to put the wheels back on the vehicle, you'll know what positions they came from and what positions they need to go in based on the tire rotation pattern indicated in your service manual. Okay, you may have noticed when I was taking the lug nuts, breaking the lug nuts loose, I didn't have my safety glasses on or my gloves, but I do now, so make sure you have yours on as well when you're working on your vehicle. Now, the next thing I want to do is start raising the vehicle up and putting it on jack stands. So let me show you what I have set up here. I put some plywood down on the ground underneath the vehicle so that the jack stands will have a good base to rest on and they won't sink into the dirt. And also the jack itself will have a good base to rest on. Now if you see here, I've stacked up three layers of 2x4s. I've got six all together. And I've got my jack here. Now the reason why I did that was to kind of give my jack a little bit of a boost or a head start so that I can have it get the vehicle up off the ground a little bit higher. And let's take a little bit closer look here. Here's the jack stand. If you notice here, it has up printed on it and a little arrow pointing clockwise so that if I turn it clockwise, it's going to raise the jack. And another arrow on the bottom marked with DN for down, which points in the counterclockwise direction. So if you turn it counterclockwise, it's going to lower the jack. And the place I'm going to position it in, let's see if I can get under here and give you a good view. I want to put the jack right under here near this little hole in the frame. Now the hole's not too big so that the jack's not going to go through the hole. The jack's big enough to prevent it from going through the hole, but it's a good place. It'll kind of lock into that little hole there. And so I'll put it in place there. Then I'll just double check that I have it positioned over my 2x4 as well. Yeah, let's get it moved over just a little bit. And then I can start raising it up by hand a little bit. And then what I'll do is I'll get my extensions for my jack and raise it up the rest of the way. Now when you're jacking up a vehicle, you don't want to be under the vehicle at the same time. You don't want to have any parts of your body under the vehicle when you're jacking it up, just in case it falls, so that, you know, you don't want to be crushed. And to make it so that you can turn the knob on the jack and not be under the vehicle comes with this extension rod set. And it has three rods right here and a little lug wrench. Okay, now this end right here goes into the corresponding groove that we just saw on the jack. And if you notice, it's got a little hook on the end. And what that allows you to do is to not only push the jack forward or move it side to side while it's under the vehicle, but also pull it back if you've got just the right touch. Now, if you pull it back and don't have it positioned quite right, it will come out of the little hole. But if you have it locked in there well, you can pull back on the rod and it will also slide the jack back so that you can change the positioning of it slightly. Okay, so let's see how these all go together. If you notice on each one, there's a little spring-loaded locking mechanism on each one, and that locks into the corresponding hole on the other ones. Okay, so let's go ahead and assemble these. See if I can do this while I'm holding the camera. Hold on with my foot here and see if we can slide that together. Okay, so see how they're locked together right there? And that little spring-loaded piece will just hold them together while you're turning the jack, and it will allow you to not only push on the extension rods to push the jack forward, but it'll also allow you to pull on them to bring it back if necessary. Okay, so let's connect the other one here. And let's find where the hole is. Okay, push it down, lock it in place. All right, now we've got the next one here. Now this is the lug wrench. And if you notice, it's got a little square hole right here
for the last extension rod to go into. So let's see if we can put that in place. Get it lined up there. Push down on the little spring-loaded part. And let's see if we can get it to... Oops. Let's watch it lock into place there. There we go. Okay, so now we've got the extension rod, or the lug wrench attached to the extension rods, and we can insert them into the hole in the jack and turn the jack clockwise to raise the vehicle.
Now, before I raise the front of the vehicle as a safety measure to prevent the vehicle from rolling and falling down, what I want to do is I want to set the emergency brake, which will lock the rear wheels in place to help prevent the vehicle from moving. And to set the emergency brake, what I'll do is press down on this pedal right here, which is on the driver's side of the vehicle. Okay, so that's the emergency brake, and now it's set. In addition to setting my emergency brake, which will hold the rear wheels, I've also placed some chocks under the rear wheels. So I carry this little fold-up chock, and I also carry some bricks with me that I can use to chalk the wheels. So here's the little fold-up chock under the front of the passenger side rear wheel. Over here's a little brick under the rear of the wheel. Let's go around to the other side. And here's another brick under the rear of the driver's side rear wheel. And another brick under the front. And I just carry these with me in case I ever need to raise the vehicle and remove the front wheels. Or I can also chalk the front wheels and remove the rear wheels. So it's just another safety measure to help prevent the vehicle from rolling. Now, in addition to chalking the wheels, as a safety measure, what I also want to do, once I'm done raising the front wheels and putting them on jack stands, I want to make sure I leave the front wheels on as I'm raising the rear wheels and putting them on jack stands, because just in case the vehicle moves and falls off the jack stands, there's going to be less likely to be any serious damage to the vehicle if the vehicle lands on its tires instead of landing on the brake calipers and the frame of the vehicle. So again, I want to make sure that when I'm jacking up the rear wheels, I leave the front wheels on, and I'm only going to take all the wheels off once I have the entire vehicle set down and secure on four jack stands.
Okay, I have the extension rods inserted into the hole on the knob of the jack, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the knob clockwise to raise the vehicle. And as I'm doing this, I want to turn it a little bit and then periodically check the vehicle to make sure that the jack is still properly positioned under the vehicle and that it's not likely to fall. So let's go ahead and see what it looks like when I raise the vehicle. Okay, so I'm going to grab the lug wrench and the extension rod, and I'm just going to turn it clockwise to raise the vehicle. And we'll get it up a little ways and then just check it to make sure everything looks like it's still secure. And again, we have the emergency brake set and the rear wheels chalked. Okay, so let's take a look underneath. Okay, I think it's secure. And again, you don't want to put any part of your body underneath the vehicle while you're jacking it if it's not on jack stands, just in case it falls. This will give you a good workout too. Let's check it again.
Okay, I think it still looks good. And the wheel
is off the ground, but I want to let it, I want to raise it up a little bit more, because once I raise up the other side, this side is likely to lower again and actually touch the ground again. Let's check it again.
Okay, still looks good.
Nice and straight. Okay, I think that's probably good. So I'm gonna go ahead and get my jack and put it under the truck. Or my jack stand and put it under the truck. Okay, so I took a little break and then I raised the truck up a little bit more with the jack, and I put the jack stand in place, the jack stand on top of the piece of plywood that I have to prevent the jack stand from sinking into the dirt when I put the weight of the vehicle on it. And let me show you where I'm going to let the vehicle rest on the jack stand. And I don't want to get under the vehicle, but if you can see the top of the jack stand, and we'll get a little side view here, and the little shiny area on the frame right above the jack stand, that's where the jack stand hit the last time. So I'm gonna let that position of the frame rest on the top of the jack stand, and that's where I've used it successfully before. So let's see kind of where it is in relation to the rest of the frame underneath the vehicle, and you'll get an idea. And then I've got it raised up as far as it can go. You can see there's teeth on the jack stand that will lock in place to allow the height to be adjusted, and then this little handle that you can release, that you can lift up, and it'll allow the shaft of the jack stand to go down all the way. But I've got it raised up as far as it'll go underneath the frame, and then I'm going to turn the jack counterclockwise and lower it so that the weight of the vehicle will then rest on the jack stand. Okay, so now I'm going to turn the yellow knob on the jack counterclockwise, and that will allow the jack to lower, and that will allow the full weight of the vehicle to rest on the gray and black jack stand that I have on the left. So let's go ahead and turn it counterclockwise and let it down. We'll go a little bit at a time. Okay, and this is the point where you can't really avoid putting, you know, like your arm underneath the vehicle, but at least the jack stand is there to hopefully catch it, and hopefully you won't have any problems. But really the best thing to do is to have, you know, some type of long board or hook to position the jack stand, but I don't have that. So, but it looks like it's well positioned under the frame, and I'm going to lower the vehicle the rest of the way. Double check it again. Okay, so I think it's good and secure, and I'm going to let the full weight of the vehicle down on the jack stand now.
Okay, so now you can see that the full weight of the vehicle is now on the jack stand.
And also,
my wheel is off the ground, and it can now be taken off the vehicle. And hopefully...
Hopefully it's raised up enough so that when I raise up the other side, this side, the passenger side front wheel, won't touch the ground again. Okay, so I've jacked up the front driver's side wheel, and I went through the same procedure that I went through for the passenger side front wheel. I basically stacked up the 2x4s, I put three layers of 2x4s on the ground, put the jack on top of that, positioned it under the same hole in the frame on the driver's side as I did on the passenger side. I jacked it up, then I placed my gray and black jack stand under the same relative position under the frame, and then I just lowered the jack so that the full weight of the truck is now on the jack stand. And as you can see, the front wheel on the driver's side is off the ground, and the front wheel on the passenger side is on the ground. So now I'm going to show you how I will jack up the rear of the vehicle. Okay, I'm under the rear of the truck near the rear axle, and as you can see, I've got my stack of 2x4s stacked in three layers, and two rows of 2x4s side by side. Here's the jack and the little yellow knob, and I have it positioned, let's see if we can get a good view here, directly under this little indentation, which is intentionally designed into the frame member, under the, it's a little piece that's built into the axle where the head of the jack can go into. Okay, so I'll raise the jack a little bit, let's get it properly positioned under there, and as you can see, as I raise it up by hand, by turning the knob clockwise, the yellow knob clockwise, fits right in that little pocket there. So, and that's purposely, that has been purposely put there for use with the head of the jack. Alright, and then I have my small jack stand on some plywood, again so that it doesn't sink into the dirt when I have the full weight of the truck on it, and I have that positioned very close to the differential right under the rear axle, and so I think that will be a good position to have it in right here. Alright, so and here's what the rest of it looks like underneath. That's just the rest of the axle. And again, the differential and the jack stand and the jack with the head of the jack positioned in that little indented area. All right, so let's go ahead and put the extension rod in the little receiving slot here on the knob of the jack, and we'll turn it clockwise to raise the truck up in the rear. And I wanted to give you another view of what it looks like a little bit farther away from the jack and the jack stand. And you can see the stack of 2x4s, the jack on the left and the jack stand on the right, just to the left of the rear differential. Okay, so let's go ahead and jack it up. All right, so as you can see, the extension rods, the full length of them, extends out beyond the end of the rear bumper, so that you don't have to get under the vehicle when you're jacking up the jack, or when you're jacking up the vehicle with the jack. You can see the lug wrench that I have is just beyond, just to the left of my trailer hitch that's sticking out from the rear bumper. So I'm going to go ahead and jack it up, and we'll take a look at it just to make sure it's secure, and then we'll go ahead and lower or raise the jack stand up to the full height that it has under the rear axle, and then we'll lower the rear of the truck so that the full weight of the truck is on the jack stand. And again, I'm going to turn it clockwise
to raise the vehicle. And I want to check it every once in a while. Make sure it still looks good. Yep, I think that's good. Okay, the driver's side rear wheel is now off the ground. And I want to take a look up towards the front of the truck to make sure that the jack stands in the front still look secure. I think everything up front looks good as well, so I'll jack it up a little bit more. Again, I'm turning the yellow knob clockwise to jack it up. And I want to give it a little extra height above the ground so that when I lower it and let the full weight of the truck rest on the jack stand, the jack stand is going to sink down a little bit, and I want to have a little bit of extra gap so that the wheel doesn't, so that the tire doesn't rest on the ground again. Okay, I think that's good. So now I've got to kind of reposition the jack stand and then lower the jack so that the full weight of the truck rests on the jack stand.
Okay, it's Sunday, July 19th, 2015 at 11:47 a.m. And last night I let the truck down to put the full weight of the truck on the jack stand here, but when I did that, the leg of the jack stand punched through the plywood, and it also wasn't very level. It wasn't standing upright. It was leaning towards the driver's side of the vehicle because the ground here isn't completely level. So what I did was, to keep the jack stand from punching through the plywood, I added some 2x4s here, and then I also put a little shim between two of the 2x4s to kind of help level it out. And so now it looks fairly level. And you can see the jack stands that I have up in the front. There's one there, and there's the other one on the passenger side. Those are good and secure. The front wheels are off the ground, and the rear wheel back here is off the ground. So now all that's left to do is raise up the rear wheel on the passenger side. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay, I now have the rear passenger side wheel up off the ground, and the truck has its full weight on the jack stand. And here's the jack stand here. I've got another set of 2x4s. I've got, let's see, two layers of 2x4s here, holding it up on top of my plywood. And here it is, and it's just to the pass, it's just on the passenger side of the differential. Okay, you can see where the differential is resting on the jack stand. And then I left the jack in place so you could see the corresponding little pocket there that it fits into on the passenger side in the rear. So there's the jack, and I'll probably just leave it there for now. But the weight of the truck is resting on the jack stand. And then here's the other jack stand, and it's just to the driver's side of the differential. And those are some good places to put your jack stands if you want to support the rear of your truck. And let's come out here a little bit and get a more distant view of everything.
and I checked and all the wheels are off the ground, so we can start taking the wheels off the truck.
All right, so I'm going to show you how to take off the passenger side front wheel, and remember, we want to turn the lug nuts lefty-loosey or counterclockwise. All right, and then I'll go ahead and I'll do the same for the other ones. Now, remember, we broke the lug nuts loose while the truck was still on the ground, and so now, hopefully, it'll be easy to turn the lug nuts and remove them the rest of the way from the bolts that they're screwed onto. All right, let's go ahead and do that.
Alright, so it's loose enough to where I can just unscrew it with my fingers. And there we go. Got one of them off. That was pretty easy. And that was because we broke them loose before we lifted the truck off the ground. And since they're loose already, you don't really need to alternate, but I like to just do it out of habit. They're loose already, so a crisscross pattern isn't really necessary. And you want to make sure that once you take all the lug nuts off, you put them in a container so you don't lose them. And keep them all together in a good place that won't be disturbed. Because the last thing you want to do is be looking for your lug nuts when you're in a hurry to get it back together. Okay, so we got all the lug nuts off. Let's put them to the side. And then let's take the wheel off.
Okay, so there we go. We've got the passenger side front wheel off, and I'll go ahead and I'll take the rest of the wheels off, and then we'll inspect the brakes. All right, I have the passenger side front wheel off, and I'm looking at the passenger side front brake assembly right now. So let's go ahead and inspect everything and make sure everything looks good. Now, one thing I noticed when I looked initially, let's see if we can get a good shot in there. You'll see that the wear sensor, which is right here, is nowhere near touching the discs. So we've got plenty of thickness on the brake pads still, at least on this side, from what you can see. So we don't have to worry about changing that. And if you look on the inside here, let me get my pointer and see if we can get enough light in there. It's a little hard to see because it's kind of dark, but
Let's see. There's still plenty of thickness. I looked in there earlier with a flashlight, and there's still plenty of thickness on this pad as well. So we got lucky on this one here. There's no pads that need to be replaced. But since we have the wheel off, let's go ahead and inspect everything else also. Now, for the discs, you want to make sure that they're nice and smooth still. You may have some slight grooves, but in general, they should be fairly smooth. So these look like they're in really good condition. Let me rotate it here, and you can see that the surface of the disc is nice and smooth still. All right, same for the inner surface. No deep grooves or pits. It's still in good shape. All right, and then let's look for any leaking hoses or any other problems. So looks like the hoses look good. In fact, you don't want to clean anything off yet until you've had a chance to inspect everything. So there's the hose that goes into the caliper. In fact, this is, if you've never seen a brake caliper before, this is it right here. This is the caliper. We've got the brake shoe, the outer brake shoe right here, or the outer brake pad right there. They're the little brackets that I was talking to you about that come in the set for the new brakes. This is one of those pieces right there. All right, and then these are kind of the little fingers that help to hold the brake pads in place. And on the inside, let's see if we can get somewhat of a view. Well, in this caliper there, in fact, here's the body for one of the cylinders right there. There it is. Oh, it got a little wet from the water on the ground. And then I think, let's see, I think right in there is probably another cylinder. And inside those cylinders are pistons. And when you step on the brake pedal, it pushes a piston in the master cylinder up above in the engine compartment, and that pushes hydraulic brake fluid down through, let's see here, down through this hose right there, and then into those two cylinders, and that hydraulic fluid pushes the pistons in the cylinders, and those push against the brake pads, and then those brake pads, what they'll do is, let's see if we can get a good shot right here maybe. Let's see, here's one of the brake pads, and here's the other brake pad right there, and then here's the disc. Okay, those brake pads will squeeze together and squeeze the disc and cause it cause the vehicle to slow down. Okay, so basically whenever you apply your brakes, hydraulic fluid is pushed into the brake caliper, which is right here, and that squeezes the pads together, which squeeze on the disc, and because of friction it causes the truck to slow down. All right, so let's do a little more inspecting here. Again, I think we've got plenty of thickness on the pads. You can see the thickness of the inner pad here and the thickness of the outer pad here. And again, the wear sensor, which is right here, is still way far away. We've got from here to here before we start having contact between the wear sensor and the disc. Okay, the disc is also referred to as the rotor. All right, so let's do a little more inspecting. Let's see, this looks all right up here. I'm not going to bother greasing the suspension linkages here. Here's one of the grease fittings, because I did that just a few months ago when I was doing some other work. All right, so that should still be good. Now, one thing I noticed before when I was doing my inspection is that this pad right here is starting to deteriorate. And I think, maybe not this one, but probably the one on the other side, which I think is in a little bit worse condition, I think that may be causing some of the creaking noise. I think when I go up and down over bumps, since not much of these are left, some of the metal pieces of the truck may be hitting together and causing some of the creaking noises that I've been hearing for, I don't know, probably the past year or so since I've been driving my truck around. So one of these days I'm going to have to get some more of these pads, get some new ones and replace them. And then here's the shock absorber right here. When you go over a bump, that kind of absorbs some of the shock. Okay. And I believe they also have an integral spring as well. All right, everything else seems to look pretty good. We've got the brake line here, the metal portion of the brake line. Goes down to the rubber portion here. And right here, you also want to check these for cracks. If they look like they're starting to crack, you want to replace them. Okay, here's the rest of the brake line. All right. And then let's just do a quick look over. Here's the wheel well here. And I think everything else looks pretty good. I don't see any leaking around here. Here's the exhaust manifold here and the heat shield. Here's one of the spark plugs up here. Or the spark plug wire actually, and the spark plug is underneath there. Okay, we've got a little sensor wire there. Now that sensor wire, that's probably, let's follow it down here. My hunch is that that's most likely for the anti-lock braking system. It goes down into here. And that's most likely what's used to sense the wheel speed for the anti-lock braking system. If the anti-lock braking system notices that one wheel is kind of stopped and the other ones are still spinning, it will kind of loosen up the brakes on that particular wheel to try to let it continue to spin just a little bit so that you don't go into a slide. Okay. Do a little bit more of an inspection. Now I think I may also be getting some squeaking from right around here as well. I'm going to try to lubricate that again sometime and see if that helps to eliminate some of the squeaking that I've been hearing when I go over certain bumps. Alright, here's one of the suspension linkages. That looks good. Now I also noticed that these little rings right here seem to be loose. I'm not sure exactly what those are for, and I looked under here. I'm guessing they're part of that little bushing here, but I'm not sure what it originally looked like, but it doesn't look like it's in too bad a condition now. The little bushing there is cracked, but I think it's probably still usable, but that's something that I should replace during the next time I do service in this area of the truck. And then also over here, which I don't think is too big of a deal, I greased it and the hole's not too bad, it's not leaking out too badly, but got a little bit of grease leaking out right here. So, and when I greased it the last time, I could see it kind of ooze out. Alright, let's do a little more inspecting. We've got another grease fitting down here. And I think overall it looks pretty good. Alright, so I don't think we have to do the brake pads on the front. And we'll take a look real quick at the brakes on the in the front on the driver's side as well. So let's go do that. Okay, so here are the here's the brake setup on the driver's side in the front. So let's take a look to see how the pads look on this one first. And let's see if we can get in here, get a good view. All right, yeah, let's see. Right about there. It's a little dark in there, but you can see there's the wear sensor, and there is the surface of the disc or the rotor, and we've got plenty of pad between the two. So we don't need to replace the pads on the front here. And let's just double check the ones on the one on the inside. And that's got plenty of pad thickness as well. I did look at it before with a flashlight, and it's a little tough to see here with the light on the camera, but there's still plenty of thickness on that. And you can kind of see where there's the, you can kind of see the bevel of the pad, or the chamfer on the end of the pad down there. So there's still plenty of pad thickness left on this side in the front. Also, let's take a look at the surface of the rotor, or the disc. The inside surface looks good. Not any major grooves or pits. If you see these fins here, I believe these are mainly there for to help cool the disc, because you don't want it to get too hot, because if it does, it will cause warping of the disc, and then you can have pulsing, or you'll feel a pulsation in your brake pedal when you hit the brakes. Now, if you really cram on the, if you really slam on the brakes, you may feel pulsation from the ABS brake system, and that's by design. The ABS or anti-lock brake system will pulse the brake so that the wheels don't lock up and you go into a skid or a slide. All right, so let's look at the surface of the rotor on this side. And there's some, a little bit of rust, but that's no big deal, and that comes off whenever the brakes are applied. But overall, it looks like it's in fairly good condition. And then another thing you want to do, if we were to take these rotors off and have them turned, is we'd want to check to make sure they have not reached their minimum thickness. Because once they get down to a certain thickness, you can't use them anymore and you have to get new ones. So whenever you take your rotors to get them turned, on the inside of the rotor will be molded into the rotor the minimum thickness, and you want to have the shop that turns the rotors for you check that to make sure that the rotors have not gone down to their minimum thickness, and if so, you need to replace them. Okay, so this rotor looks pretty good right here, and let's check everything else just to make sure it's in good condition. Here's that bleed screw I was mentioning before. It's underneath this little cap, and if we had to replace the shoes, we would put the C-clamp over this, compress the piston inside the caliper, and at the same time open up this bleed screw and allow some of the fluid to come out. Okay, so let's continue with our inspection here. Now, there is a little bit of sign of fluid here, but I don't think that's from the brakes. I think that is probably left over from when I was working on my power steering pump, and what I was doing was draining out the power steering fluid, running the power steering pump a little bit, then draining it out, and I did that probably about 10 times. And during every time I would drain it out, some of it would drip down onto the frame, and I think that's what that's from. Now, to find out for sure, the best thing to do would be to clean all of this off, get a real clean, and then drive it around for a little while, and also monitor the brake fluid level. And then after a while of driving, if I noticed that there was another stain here, then that would be a good indication that it's probably leaking from here, but I don't think it is. So the hose again, it looks like it's in good condition, no cracking. It doesn't look like there's any obvious signs of damage. Okay, think it looks good. Let's see here. I don't see any signs of leaking. Let's see if we can get a look on the inside here. Okay. And again, that little pad right there on this side, it's pretty much completely gone. So I'll have to replace that one of these days. And that may be one of the sources of noise. In fact, if you see here, see those little rust marks, that may be where this may be hitting up against there. I'm not sure if it has enough travel to hit that or not, but that may be hitting there, and that may be one of the sources of the squeaking that I've been hearing when I go over bumps sometimes. Okay, so let's take a little bit more of a look, see if everything looks good. Look in the wheel well. Okay, it looks like the bushings look good. The suspension, I'm not sure if there should be something there or not. Probably not. That looks pretty narrow. But we'll look in my service manual later to find out. Here's another one of the grease fittings. And I think overall it looks good under here. Here's a little boot for the steering linkage. And so I think we're in pretty good shape under here. Okay. Now, and I do have a little bit of grease leaking out here, but I don't think that's too big of a deal. Every time I grease my suspension linkages periodically whenever I do an oil change. So I think we're good to go there. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll put, as just a safety measure, we'll put the front wheels back on since we don't need to work on the front brakes. We'll put those back on and then we'll take off the rear wheels and take a look at the rear brakes. Okay, so since we don't have to work on any of the brake pads on the front, I wanted to show you my technique for putting the wheel back on. This can be kind of tricky if your wheel is heavy. Some of the tips are, one of the main things is to make sure you don't lift the truck up off the ground any higher than you really need to. You want to lift it up just enough to where you can easily take the wheel off, but you don't want it much higher than that, because the higher it is, the higher you're going to have to lift the wheel to put it back on the truck. So keep the truck as low as you can so that you don't have to lift the wheel very high when you go ahead and put it back on. Now, for wheels that are really heavy, one of the things that I like to do is put the wheel as close to the place where it's going to be mounted on the truck as possible, and then I'll kind of straddle the wheel with my feet and put my feet on either side of the tire, and then kind of push the tire up onto my foot, and then put the other foot on the other side and kind of just jack up the tire with my feet, and then I can put the wheel in place where it's supposed to be installed. And that helps so that I don't have to hold it up as much with my arms while I'm trying to put it in. So let's go ahead and put that on. I inspected the thickness of the tread on the rear and front tires and noticed that the tread on the rear tires is thinner than the tread on the front tire. So I think, if I remember correctly, I think the tread on the front tires wears faster, so I'm just going to leave the front tires where they are because they're thicker and I think they're going to wear at a faster rate. So I want the thicker treaded tires on the front, and I'm going to leave the rear tires in place where they are. Alright, so let's go ahead and put the passenger side front tire back on. And I've got a container with my lug nuts right here. Easy and in a handy place to grab them so they don't roll off. They're not going to roll very far in the grass anyways, but it just makes it more convenient. And I've got my tools ready to go to put the lug nuts back on. Put those over here. Now I'll roll the wheel and I'll roll the tire into place.
All right, and I'll kind of straddle it with my feet. Then I want to line up the studs with the holes on the wheel. Kind of lift it up. Let's see if I can see where. Okay, there's one. This wheel's not too heavy, but on like some trucks with really big wheels, it's almost impossible to lift them up with just your arms. You have to use your feet to kind of get them in place. Also, you may have heard me use the word tire and the word wheel. Well, specifically, this is the tire right here, and this metal portion is the wheel. So, but they're all just one big assembly. So again, this is the tire. And this is the wheel. All right, so now we'll go ahead and we'll start putting the lug nuts on. I've got them here in my little container. We'll just put them, you want to start them with your fingers first, because if you start them with a tool, like a wrench or an impact wrench, you can cross-thread them, and that will damage the threads on the studs and also the lug nuts themselves. So if you start them with your fingers, there's no way that you're going to be able to turn them tight enough or turn them hard enough with enough torque to damage the thread. So if you feel like when you're twisting them on there that they're not going, that you encounter a lot of resistance, well, just take them off, try to reposition them a little bit, and try putting them back on again. So always start the lug nuts and any other fastener, like a bolt or a nut. It's best to start them with your fingers so you don't cross-thread them and damage the threads. Okay, so the next thing I'll do is just tighten them a little bit more with my wrench, but I'll only tighten them enough to where I start to encounter some resistance. And then after that, once I've got everything done and I'm ready to tighten up all the lug nuts on all the wheels, I'll use my torque wrench to tighten them the rest of the way. That one's kind of stuck in the socket, or the wrong socket, so I'll have to just do all these by hand, and I'll break it loose later. Sometimes you want to kind of wiggle the wheel to get it to go on there just a little bit more. Okay, so they're all on there finger tight, and what I'll do next, or actually once I'm ready to tighten them all back up, I'll get them as tight as I can while the vehicle's off the ground with the torque wrench, and then I will lift the vehicle off the jack stands, put it down on the ground, and then tighten them the rest of the way with the torque wrench.
Okay, I've taken both rear wheels off the truck now, and I looked at the brake pads and they all look good, so I won't have to do a full brake job, but I wanted to show you what I found and so that you have a good idea of what to look for when you're inspecting your brakes. Okay, so let's first take a look at the thickness of the pad. And so right down here, here's the very end of the wear sensor, right there. And then there's the surface of the rotor or the disc. And you can see that we still have quite a bit of pad left there. I'll probably check it again, maybe in about 6 months or so, or the next time I have to do any work, which requires me to take the wheels off, like, say, for example, changing the, getting new tires. When I got new tires the last time, I also checked the thickness of the brake pads just to make sure that they were good. So we've got plenty of thickness here. Let's look at the inside. And I've got my flashlight here, so hopefully I can get a better idea. Oops, here we go. Let's see. Okay, so you can see that the wear sensor is a little bit closer to the disc here. We'll have to have that other flashlight. But there's still quite a bit of space, and it's not touching. So we're definitely not, the squeaking is definitely not being caused by the wear sensors. Alright, and then let's inspect the surface of the disc. In fact, let me wipe my sweat off there. That should be all right. I'll maybe hit it with a bit of brake cleaner because we don't want any kind of grease on there, because that can reduce the efficiency of the brakes. But the rotors look good. Let's see if I can turn them here. They're a little tougher to turn. We don't see any major deep grooves. There are some slight grooves, but that's normal. And the back ones are a little bit more tough to turn because of the fact that they're connected to the axle and the drive shaft. And they're also connected together through the differential. So when I turn this one clockwise, the other one will turn in the opposite direction because they're connected through the gears in the differential. Okay. Let's get a little bit more of a look here. I think we're good. No major damage to the outside of the rotor. And let's get a little bit of an idea of what the inside looks like. So I say that looks pretty good, and I'll inspect it the rest of the way because I'll have to have both hands to really be able to turn it. Kind of difficult to turn it while I'm holding the camera, but the inside surface of the disc or the rotor looks good as well. Alright, the only other thing that I noticed on here that was a little strange, I'm thinking it's maybe just some piece of road debris. Let's see, you can see it down, looks kind of on top of the pad there next to the rotor. I'm not sure what that is, some piece of rubber or something maybe from the road, but I don't think that's a big deal. I'm gonna try to pick it out of there later, but I don't think that's causing a problem. Well, let's see if maybe we can get a better shot of what I'm talking about here. It's right about in here, but I don't think I can hold the light on there to where you can get a good view. But I'll try to take that out of there later. All right, one other thing I wanted to show you is with the front discs,
the thickness of the minimum thickness of the discs is printed on the inside of the rotor. It's molded to the inside of the rotor. Let's turn this a little bit. But on this one, instead of being molded on the inside of the rotor, it's molded on the outside here. So you can see where it says min, M-I-N-T-H-K. Well, that's short for minimum thickness. And then it says 28.5 mm or millimeters. So let's take my tape measure. Let's actually measure the thickness. Now it's actually better to use a caliper to do this. But my tape measure will give us a pretty good idea. So let's see here. So the scale on the left is in millimeters, and the 2 indicates 20 millimeters, the 3 indicates 30 millimeters. So it's right about at 30 millimeters. And the minimum thickness is 28.5. So maybe when it's turned one more time, that may be the last time it can be turned, but we still have enough thickness for now. Okay, so it's right around 30 millimeters in thickness. There we go. And let's inspect everything else under here. Let me get my pointer. Again, this pad, like the ones on the front, this one's deteriorating, and I'm gonna have to order some of these and try to replace those. I've never done that before, so hopefully it won't be too difficult, but I think it's probably a good idea to replace them to help eliminate any squeaking in the suspension. We've got the shock absorber here. It's much bigger in the back, and it probably has an integral spring in this one as well. Got the brake line, metal brake line. Don't see any problems with that. Oh, actually, no. Here's the spring. So there's no spring in this one. This just has hydraulic fluid in there, and there's a piston with, I believe, which it probably has holes in it, which goes up and down inside the fluid, and that helps to dampen out the spring motion. So the spring pushes it back down after it's compressed, but the shock absorber here helps to keep it from bouncing up and down. It bounces maybe once or twice, but it makes it so that the bounce dies out pretty quickly. So that again is the shock absorber. Okay, here's the cable for the emergency brake. And again, when you set your emergency brake, it only locks the brakes on the rear wheels, not the front. Okay, so everything there looks pretty good. Now, another thing that I forgot to mention on the front, but which I did inspect, are these little boots for the pins which the caliper moves on. So whenever you take out these pins, you want to clean them off and lubricate them as well with that grease that I showed you earlier. But you want to make sure that these boots are in good condition. I'm missing the cap for the bleed screw here, so I'm going to have to get some new caps for those to help keep the dirt out of there. It's kind of too late now anyways, but it's a good idea to have them on there. And the bleed screw, that's tightened off anyway, so nothing's actually going to get in the system, and if I were to open it, it would push anything out of there that's in there anyways. So let's check down here, make sure we don't have any leaks. Everything looks good and dry from what I can see. The hose, let me reposition here. The hose looks like it's in good condition. There's no cracks in the hose. Again, if the hose has cracks, you want to replace the hose. Let's get a shot on the inside here. Oops. See if we can see any leaks. What I can see out here, it looks good. Here is the other boot. That looks like it's in good condition. It's not cracked or torn.
You can see inside there. You can see one of the pads and the rotor or the disc. And then I think everything is in good condition overall. So luckily, I don't have to do a brake job. I just had to inspect them.
And let's just take a quick look around. I think everything else looks pretty good. Okay, suspension looks good. And I think we're good to go. All right, I don't see any obvious problems on this side. Let's go take a look on the passenger side in the rear.
Okay, now remember how I said that there was something on top of the brake pad and I wasn't sure what it was. It looked like some type of debris. Well, I found something interesting. I picked it out and this is what I found. An old dried up mummified lizard corpse. This is the first time I've seen that in a brake. And so here's the poor guy. I don't know how long he's been riding along there, but there's his little body. He's all dried up and pretty rough looking. I think he's seen better days. So he's been riding along on that brake pad for a long time, his little dead body. So we'll I think that's what it is. It sure as heck looks like an old lizard. Not sure what else it might be. Looks like his little legs there, and poor guy. So we'll, yeah, there's his little legs. There he is, and we'll put him in the grass and let him turn to fertilizer. Okay, so now let's inspect the brake assembly on the rear of the vehicle on the passenger side. Let's take a look at the wear sensor and see how far away it is from the rotor. So here's the end of the wear sensor right there, and then there's the surface of the rotor. So we've got quite a bit of space left, quite a bit of thickness left in the pads before we have to replace them. And let's take a look from the top on the inside. I think I'm going to have to get my other flashlight so where we can get a little more light in there. Okay, so you can see the end of the wear sensor, and there's quite a bit of thickness there between the wear sensor and the surface of the rotor. So we don't have to worry about that pad either. So luckily we don't have to do any of the brakes. We don't have to change any of the brake pads. And that'll save a lot of time. So let's just inspect the surface of the rotor. We have some minor grooves, but nothing unusual. No pits or anything. Look around. I'm not going to rotate it because it's pretty tough to turn with just one hand, but I looked around the whole circumference of it and it looks pretty good. We'll take a quick look on the inside surface and get an example of what that looks like. And again, that looks fairly shiny and no major grooves. I'd say we're in good shape there. Alright. And let's take a look around just at the brake lines. Okay, so here's the metal brake line right there. Let's follow that. Okay, the hose looks good. No cracks in the hose. Let's check for any leaks. I don't see any signs of leakage. Let's look on the inside here. Ooh, see if we can get in there. Yeah, so I think we're pretty good there. Take a look at it from the bottom. We'll also look at the thickness of the pads from the bottom, because they can vary in thickness from end to end of the pads. So let's take a quick look. All right, let's see here. Alright, that one looks good. Looks like it's got plenty of thickness left still. I think we'll be good for a while. But I will check it in probably, maybe about another 6 months or so. And let's see if we can get a good view here. And we still have quite a bit of pad there, and the surface of the rotor looks good on the inside. I don't see any signs of leaks. Let's see. The boot right here looks good, which is over the pin. And we'll do a quick check of the emergency brake cable. I think that looks good. No signs of damage there. Let's follow it back. I think it's all right. Okay. And we'll check the boot up top here as well. Okay, so that boot looks good. Doesn't look cracked. Doesn't look like it's torn. Looks like it's positioned well. So I think that's good. Now that you know what to look for when inspecting the thickness of your brake pads, even if you don't do the work yourself, always insist on visually inspecting the pads before you have any work done. If you're going to take your vehicle to a shop and have a mechanic work on it, before you even take it to the shop, call them up and ask them if it's okay with them if you visually inspect your brake pads before they do any work. If they give you any excuses and tell you that you're not allowed in the work area or you're not allowed to look at them for some reason, don't take it to that shop, because there's a lot of good, honest mechanics in the world, but unfortunately there's also a lot of dishonest mechanics as well. So always insist on being able to visually inspect your brake pads and your rotors and the rest of the equipment underneath before you take it to a shop. Okay? So don't let any shop work on it before you have a chance to visually inspect it yourself and verify that your pads actually need to be replaced. Now there's one other thing that I forgot to point out. The little bleed screw here, we need another cap for that one. So I'll get a set of caps and put those on as well, just to keep junk from getting inside that bleed screw. Alright, so but overall it looks good. Also going to have to replace this pad on this side, so I'll order those. Do one last quick look on the passenger side and the rear. But I think overall everything looks pretty good. No leaks, the rotors look good, and we have good thickness on the brake pads. In fact, let's, before I forget, let's look at the thickness of the rotors. And again, these, let's see, they're at about 30 millimeters again. I'd say, just about 30 millimeters in thickness there. And again, remember that the minimum thickness is 28.5 millimeters. Right here. Okay, so there we go. Luckily I don't have to change the brake pads on my truck. Everything looks good, and I'll do another inspection a little bit later on down the road. Alright, let's go ahead and we'll put the wheels back on and then tighten up the lug nuts. Okay, the next thing I want to do is I want to tighten all of the lug nuts on all of the wheels, and I wanted to give you a demonstration of that using the passenger side rear wheel. Now the rear wheel on the passenger side is still off the ground, but I've set the emergency brake, and I think that will hold the wheel well enough so that I can completely tighten all of the lug nuts. And the way I'm going to tighten the lug nuts to the proper torque is by using this tool right here, which I showed you earlier. This is my torque wrench. Okay, and with this I can set the torque, or the twisting force of the wrench, to a particular setting by looking in this. Here's the scale in foot-pounds,
And here it is in Newton meters. That's the metric measurement of torque. All right. And depending on how this is set, the higher I set it, the more twisting force I can use before it clicks. And once it clicks, that means I've reached the set torque and I don't want to tighten it any further. All right, so the torque specification in my Haynes service manual is 140 foot-pounds. Again, that's 140 foot-pounds for each lug nut on each of the wheels. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do that in stages. First, I'm going to set my torque wrench to 100 foot-pounds. Then I'm going to go around in a crisscross pattern, tighten all the lug nuts. Then I'm going to set it to 120 foot-pounds. Then go around in a crisscross pattern again until I'm going to tighten it until the torque wrench clicks. And then I will set it to the final setting of 140 foot-pounds and go around in a crisscross pattern one more time until all of the lug nuts are completely tightened to the specified torque of 140 foot-pounds. So to set the torque on this tool, I need to pull down on this little knob. All right, that will unlock it. I'll pull it down, and then let's turn it. Oops. We have to turn it clockwise, and as you can see, the numbers on the scale are increasing: 36, 38, 40. We'll keep going up, and that's, I'm looking at the foot-pound scale. So we'll keep going. We'll turn it all the way up to 100 foot-pounds. Keep going. 82, 96, 98, 100 foot-pounds. So then we'll just let it lock into place. All right. We have it set to 100 foot-pounds. Then I'll go ahead and I'll tighten the lug nuts. And again, I'm going to do it in a crisscross pattern. So we'll do this special one first. Just want to get them to a low torque at first. Remember to use a crisscross pattern. That it's reached 100 foot-pounds of torque, so I don't want to tighten that one anymore. I think I kind of got mixed up on my crisscross pattern here, but there's the click. Do this other one. Actually, let's do this one. Then do this one. Click. Oops. Have a problem with my torque wrench here. Let's see if we can get this working again. Well, I may have a broken torque wrench here. Just my luck. There we go. Okay, so let's try that again. This one. There we go. There's the click. Take this one off. And do this one. Alright. Take the torque wrench off. I'll
set it up to 120 foot-pounds. Okay, and we'll continue in a crisscross pattern. Here's the click. Take it off and put the other socket on. Here's the click. Set it up to the final torque of 140 foot-pounds. All right. Do this oddball one here first. Have to put a lot more force into that. Okay, there's the click. Go continue in our crisscross pattern. Click. 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 And we'll go around one more time just for good measure. Click. Click. There we go. Click. Okay,
so I have all of the lug nuts torqued to 140 foot-pounds, and then now that I'm done, what I want to do is, if I wasn't going to go on immediately to the next lug nuts on the other wheels, what I'd want to do before I put my torque wrench back into storage is set it back down to the minimum torque. Okay, if you leave it set to a high torque, it can screw up the calibration of your torque wrench. Okay, so let's go ahead, and you can see that it's right at about 140 foot-pounds, which was the maximum that I had it at, and we'll turn it down just to where it says stop. Keep turning it counterclockwise, and again you have to pull out on that knob to get it to release. Keep going. About 88 foot-pounds. 76. 46. Let's get a little closer here. 32, 30, 28, 26, 25, stop. Okay, and then there's also, if you see on the Newton meter scale, there's a stop there as well. Okay, so I just like to leave it set at stop, and that's how you should leave it when you store it. Okay, but I'll go along and I will use the torque wrench to torque the lug nuts
on the remaining wheels to 140 foot-pounds. Again, I'll start at 100 foot-pounds, go around in a crisscross pattern, increase it to 120 foot-pounds, go around in a crisscross pattern, and then set the torque wrench to the final torque of 140 foot-pounds, and then go around in a crisscross pattern again. And I'll go around once more just to make sure everything is properly torqued.
All right, now for everyone's reference, I don't know when I did when I changed the brake pads the last time. Unfortunately, I looked in my little log that I keep of maintenance records, and unfortunately, I don't think I documented when I did the brakes the last time. But my vehicle is a 2003 Chevy Avalanche. Today is Sunday, July 19th, 2015. It's 5:07 p.m. actually. And the current mileage is 130,754 miles. And then on the engine, let's see here, the hour meter is 4,553.9 hours. So that'll give you somewhat of an idea how much use my vehicle has had. Also, if you didn't know in if you didn't notice in some of my previous videos, my gas gauge isn't working, so that's one thing that I'll have to check. And then also, when I drive, my speedometer is completely dead. So in another video, we'll find out how to fix those problems. All right, so just one more time. The mileage again is 130,754 miles. Okay, everyone, so I've got my truck back down on the ground. I've got all the wheels on. I've got all the lug nuts tightened up to 140 foot-pounds of torque, and the truck is ready to go again. Now, what did I learn by doing this job? Well, at first I thought the recent squeaking that I started to hear when I applied the brakes might have indicated that the wear sensors were getting to the point where they were scraping on the rotors. But as you saw, there's still quite a bit of thickness left on the brake pads, so the squeaking's not coming from the wear sensors. What it may be, I'm guessing, is the fact that the disc brake quiet stuff that I sprayed on the pads when I first installed them, that stuff has probably long baked away by the heating of the brakes, and so there's nothing in there to keep them from squeaking anymore when you apply the brakes, and I don't have any lubrication or anything on the back or anything else. So that's my guess as to what is causing the squeaking. Whenever I apply the brakes, the fact that the disc brake quiet compound is probably deteriorated away, that I think is what is causing the brakes to squeak. So I'll keep an eye on them. Once in a while I'll take the wheels off and check the thickness again. But at least you got a good idea as to how to check the thickness on your brakes. And again, remember, if you ever have somebody else work on the brakes for you, insist that you get to visually inspect them yourself before they do any of the work. Don't take their word for it. Always make sure that you take a look for yourself and verify that the brake pads do in fact need to be replaced. So thank you very much. Thanks for watching, and I hope you learned something. Take care.